NASA and SpaceX have been working hand in hand for a long time. This is mainly because SpaceX has so much potential to become the greatest space company in the world. Because of this, the two space agencies have been doing a lot of projects together, and they're not stopping anytime soon. In fact, the two agencies seem closer than ever. Recently, they have given some information regarding the Starling mission, and we might just see it launched. But what is the mission about? Hello everyone, and welcome back to Liftoff. Today we are going to take a look at the Starling mission and all the details concerning it. But before that, make sure you leave a like and subscribe to our channel for all things Elon Musk, space, Tesla, science, technology, and so much more. And with that, let's find out what the two agencies have planned. It was recently discovered that NASA is preparing to launch Starling. This is the first satellite swarm from the agency. Communication will happen differently this time. Instead of communicating directly with the four Starling CubeSats, the mission operators will be sending instructions to the swarm as a single entity. According to Howard Cannon, NASA Starling project manager at the NASA Ames Research Center, if this becomes successful, swarms will have the potential to revolutionize how the agency conducts some of its science. Instead of having one monolithic spacecraft that you're dependent on operating properly, you can have multiple smaller spacecraft that are less expensive. Swarms will not only help with communication, but they will also let NASA collect scientific data from many different places with a lot less help than traditional constellations. A great example is HelioSwarm, which is a $250 million mission that NASA plans to launch in 2028. This is a group of 9 satellites that NASA will use to study solar wind turbulence. The managers behind HelioSwarm will communicate with the hub satellite that is being built by Northrop Grumman. This hub will coordinate the operations of 8 smaller spacecraft built by Blue Canyon Technologies. In an email sent by Harlan Spence, it said, HelioSwarm's 9 spacecraft form an observatory to provide the first ever simultaneous multi-scale observations in the solar wind needed to understand space plasma turbulence. Spence is HelioSwarm principal investigator and director of the University of New Hampshire Institute for the Study of Earth, Oceans, and Space. Turbulence is inherently a multi-scale process, and samples from all of these scales must be taken at the same time if we want to understand how energy is transferred. Even with all the promises that have been made before, the swarms in general and the Starling mission specifically present challenges. It is not yet clear whether communications, navigation, and autonomy technologies are advanced enough to facilitate swarm operations. NASA will use the 6 months that Starling will be in operation to find out whether it is to this level as they conduct a number of experiments to help them find out. But what is this autonomy technology that NASA is talking about? SpaceX agreed about a year ago to maneuver any of the Starlink satellites that come close to the International Space Station or any other NASA spacecraft. This was especially when in low Earth orbit. It was an agreement that was signed between NASA and SpaceX. On March 18, 2021, NASA announced that it had agreed with SpaceX to coordinate operations of the ISS and any other NASA spacecraft with SpaceX's growing fleet of Starlink satellites that are already in low Earth orbit. According to NASA, the agreement was intended to formalize both parties' strong interest in the sharing of information to maintain and improve space safety. According to the agreement, SpaceX will make use of the autonomous collision avoidance feature on its Starlink satellites. This will help them move if any of the satellites comes into close proximity with a NASA spacecraft. This is to help avoid situations where both sides try to move and then run into each other. The agreement states that NASA has agreed to not maneuver in the event of a potential conjunction to ensure the parties do not inadvertently maneuver into one another. NASA will operate on the basis that the autonomous maneuvering capability of the Starlink satellites will attempt to maneuver to avoid conjunction with NASA assets, and that NASA will maintain its planned trajectory unless otherwise informed by SpaceX. The agreement clearly states the roles and responsibility that NASA and SpaceX both have when it comes to sharing information on orbital positions and maneuver plans. SpaceX is expected to notify NASA about a week before launching another batch of Starlink satellites. This is to help NASA determine whether the mission has any collision avoidance issues. In addition to that, SpaceX also agreed to launch Starlink satellites into initial orbits that are about 5 kilometers away from the ISS or any other NASA spacecraft. SpaceX is also meant to avoid any notifiable conjunctions with the ISS in general. NASA defines this as a volume of space 50 by 50 by 4 kilometers, which is all centered on the station. We already know that NASA intends to run a series of experiments to find out whether the autonomy technologies are ready for the swarm missions. But how does the agency intend to run these experiments? First of all, NASA will run an experiment on the mobile ad hoc network. The Starling mission managers will test whether the six-unit CubeSats are able to establish and maintain a dynamic communications network. Cesium Astro is the company that is providing Starlink's software-defined radios with S-band inter-satellite links. The founder and CEO, Shay Sabarpour, asked, "If one of the satellites goes out of range or fails, how do you make sure that the network still meets a certain level of reliability and throughput? That is what we are trying to solve here with NASA." After that, NASA will proceed with the Starlink Formation Flying Optical Experiment, which is better known as StarFox. Here, the Starlink satellites will mostly rely on star trackers to help them move into various formations and prevent collisions. According to Simone D'Amico, the leader of Stanford University's Space Rendezvous Laboratory, it will be the first time ever that the swarm will have the capability to navigate autonomously without the help of a GPS. It will only be using cameras that are built into the four CubeSats that are pointing toward each other. The third demo will be that of Reconfiguration and Orbit Maintenance Experiments on Board, or ROMEO. This will mostly test whether the Starlink satellites can maneuver autonomously for them to achieve their objectives. According to Austin Probe, Chief Technology Officer for Emergent Space Technologies, coordinated autonomous maneuvering will be required for future constellations and swarms where communications delays and bandwidth limitations make ground-based control impractical. ROMEO is integrating our autopilot and navigator flight software products to demonstrate autonomous station keeping and reconfiguration of the Starlink swarm. Even though the Starlink satellites will be conducting autonomous operations in orbit, L3 Harris Technologies will be running a variation of its flight dynamics planning software here on the ground. This is software that will mostly be used to see how well the autonomous satellites are handling the test scenario. The final Starlink experiment will be distributed spacecraft autonomy. This mostly relies on artificial intelligence to make some plans that are based on ionospheric observations. The Starlink satellites will have some GPS receivers that will mostly monitor ionospheric density. The satellites will also move around to further explore some of the regions of particularly high or low density. Canon says that the Starlink satellites will automatically change the way they measure to take advantage of where they are in space. The Starlink mission is said to be launched later this year from Vandenberg Space Force Base in California. It'll be launched on a Firefly Aerospace Alpha rocket. NASA is showing off its Venture-class launch services with this launch and 7 other CubeSat missions. However, before this launch, Firefly plans to complete Flight 2 first. This will be the company's 2nd orbital test launch. Firefly made its first attempt to send its first Alpha to orbit in September 2021, but it was not successful because of a failure of one of the Alpha 4 engines. The company plans to give it another go in July. Once the company completes this one, they will go as quickly as possible toward the NASA launch. This was according to Kim Jennett, Firefly Marketing Director. Once the satellites are in orbit, Blue Canyon Technologies, the Raytheon Technologies subsidiary that manufactured the Starlink satellites, will go on to provide the mission operations support. According to Stephanie Bork, BCT Starlink Program Manager, the mission gives BCT the opportunity to demonstrate the flexibility of our mission operations system from ground scheduling to retrieval and uploading mission plans to timely mission data delivery while operating a constellation of spacecraft. What do you think of the Starlink mission? Do you think the tests will be more successful? Feel free to let us know in the comment section below. Also, before you go, make sure you like this video and subscribe to our channel for all the latest updates on Elon Musk, space, Tesla, science, technology, and so much more. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.